Our guest tonight, Mr. Gene Klein, is an internationally acclaimed speaker who has spoken about his Holocaust experiences around the world for decades. It is our great honor to present Mr. Gene Klein to you this evening. Please join me in welcoming him to Fort Hays.
He carried housewares and hardware. My mother, Bertha, was a typical Jewish mother, taking care of the kids in the home. Two older sisters, Lily was 7 years older than I was, and Olga was 5 years older. And here I am, the youngest of the family. I'm the crown prince of the family. You know, in some cultures, it's very important to have a male heir carry on the name, which is wonderful. And we were Eastern European Jewish family, sort of middle class, living in a small town in the eastern part of Czechoslovakia. This is where I was born. And life was good. Czechoslovakia was born in 1918, right at the end of World War I. They took a little piece of Germany, a little piece of Poland, a little piece of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and here was this wonderful democratic country. The constitution of Czechoslovakia was based on the constitution of the US, freedom for everybody to pursue your whatever you wanted to do. We had a lot of people in our hometown, different ethnic backgrounds, different religions, and everybody got along famously. You know, we went to our own place of worship, and very loving, close family. We used to go to temple on Friday night and on Saturday, and then after temple we visited our grandparents, and we have to tell them what we did in school this week, so on and so forth. I started going to school at the age of 6, and at the age of 10 I was finished with the elementary school, and in Europe you went into this so-called gymnasium, which has nothing to do with basketball. It's just a learning experience, 8 years, that combines middle school, high school, and college. A lot of emphasis on foreign languages, because if you look at a map of Europe, you see all the different colors, different languages. First of all, you had to take Latin every year, all 8 years, because it's Latin is supposed to be the basis of a lot of the languages. And then in your third year, they gave you a choice. You could take English, French, Italian, or German. I decided to take Italian and German. And the reason for this was, I had a very musical family. My father played the violin. Both of my sisters played the piano, and I played soccer, which is not a musical instrument. But I just didn't have the patience of sitting there at the piano and practicing for hours. And it was one of those schools that you know that you are going to be taught everything that you needed to carry on after you finished your 8 years and graduated. You could go in any direction you wanted to go. You could go to universities, you could go in any kind of job because you had a good education. 1939, two historically important events happened. The first, the big one, of course, was Hitler invaded Poland, September 1st, and basically the slaughter of the Jews had started. We didn't know about this. And the other thing was this little eastern part of Czechoslovakia, where I was born, was given to Hungary. Hungary started fighting on the side of the Nazis when World War II started. And this was it. I mean, there's nothing we can do about it. We went to sleep as Czechs. We woke up as Hungarians. You have to understand that this little area here used to belong to the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and our native language was Hungarian. So no big deal, you know, we went to Hungarian schools. All the signs in the city were in Hungarian and Czech, but we spoke Hungarian at home. The war is starting. The Nazis are overrunning one country after another. We start hearing horror stories of what was happening all over, not just to the Jews, but anybody that the Third Reich, the Nazis didn't think that they are good enough people to be human beings. The only good people were the blonde, blue-eyed Nazis. This is going to be a 1,000-year country that's going to stay alive. We're going to get rid of everybody else that we don't like. And we're going to have this master race of beautiful, blonde people with blue eyes. And the war keeps going on. And in the early 40s, there's, of course, a rise of anti-Semitism because the Hungarians are fighting on the side of the Nazis. And it gets very uncomfortable and dangerous. And I remember vividly going to school on a Friday afternoon and going into my homeroom, and the teacher announces, if you're a Jewish student, don't come back on Monday. I'm in my 6th year of the 8th year gymnasium. There goes my education. My father is told, lock up your store, inventory it and lock it up. You have to understand the war is going on, not like my father had a lot of merchandise in his store, but still was a meager income of money for the family. This is going on. And then comes the really horrible thing when they single you out because of your religion. You had to start wearing the yellow star. This denotes that you're a Jew, which means if you walk down the street, there are some people who hate you for one reason or another, verbally and physically, or physically or both, attack you, so you don't go on the street unless you really have to go. And I remember also another thing, around 1943, we have a Hungarian Nazi big shot coming to our school, and just like we were sitting here in the auditorium, every student and faculty had to attend. And this man gets up on the stage where I am, and he starts talking what's going on in the war. And before you know it, he starts screaming and yelling that the war is the fault of the Jews. You don't have enough food, fault of the Jews. And we really would be a lot better off if we wouldn't have any Jews around. This is really scary to a 16-year-old kid. I am sitting with some of my soccer buddies, and I'm listening to my neighbor, who happened to be my next-door neighbor at home. We are Jewish, and I say, what have I done to deserve this? All this hate. I can't understand it. And I, of course, I go home, and I tell my parents, and I'm very upset. And they say, well, unfortunately, this is the way things are. But we are still at home. Now something happens that we don't know about, but history tells us that the Hungarians really are very tired of fighting, and they want to give up the war, but nothing happens. The next terrible thing happens is this. The Hungarian authorities, they used to post like signs on the side of the walls all over the city so everybody could read it, because there were no newspapers. as such, that on such and such a day, if you are a Jewish family, be in front of your house, take a little suitcase, a little bundle, change of clothing, food, blanket, toothbrush, cosmetic things. And sure enough, the date arrives, and my family standing in front of a beautiful house with a beautiful garden my father tended with such love and care. And the officer, Hungarian officer, comes down the street. There are whole hundreds and hundreds of Jewish families that gathered up already before they got to our street. So they are herding them in front of them. Excuse me. The officer has a list. They know exactly where all the Jewish families are living. He has my father checked off, my mother, two sisters, and I. And now we join this flood of people. We just left their homes. We have absolutely no idea what's going to happen. They are taking us out of the city. Nearby there's a huge brick factory surrounded by barbed wire. Hungarian soldiers are standing guard. This is our new home. They are putting us in low, narrow buildings that have no sides to it, just to use to keep the rain out. And they used to have shelves here, because when you form the bricks out of clay, they usually have to put it in these drying buildings. Once they are dry, they take them inside the brick factory, put them in the kilns to make bricks for building materials. And also, the reason we were here was very simple. There's a railroad siding. This is where the freight trains used to come in, get loaded with bricks, and sent all over the country, all over Europe, for building materials. Well, it's terrible. It's a little straw on the ground. Some fathers get together and they stretch rope between some of the steel posts that holds up the roof. To have a little bit of privacy, they put blankets over it. And this is our new home. Middle of the night, all of a sudden some commotion. We look up, Hungarian soldiers are coming in. One hand, flashlight. One hand, other hand, gun, pointed at you. Give me all your money, all your valuables. They take a pair of gold earrings off my sister Lily. And this total stranger, this soldier comes up to me and takes off the watch on my arm, which I got from my favorite uncle on the occasion of Bar Mitzvah, which in Jewish religion at the age of 13 you become a man. And this was a very wonderful, dear present to me. And this total stranger just took it off my arm. I couldn't understand how something like this can happen. I was living in a sheltered, loving family, never knowing the horrors of life, and now all of a sudden, from one day to the next, here it is. And it's very scary. We are there just for a few days, and in the middle of the night we hear a train whistle. Our train has arrived. Hungarian soldiers are waking us up very early in the morning. Get your bundles together, your suitcases. Let's go. We're going to get on the train. There was a lot of rumors. They were saying families will be kept together. They're going to get on trains. They're going to send us all over Europe in the Nazi-occupied areas. We're going to be working in factories for the war effort and on the farms, etc. Total propaganda. They were just trying to keep you calm so you won't try it. And as you're passing by a large building, before you get to the place where the train is, Hungarian soldiers are telling you, put all your belongings down, you're not going to need it where you're going. And my father, thinking that something horrific is waiting for us, whispering to us, if you have any food in your bundle, put it in your pocket. I take out an apple and a piece of bread. And now we are marching around the bend. The first thing we see is the SS. These are the murderers. These are the units that follow all the Nazi troops all over Europe, and they do the killing. The killing of men, women, and children. This is their job. This is part of the solution. We are going to kill all the Jews in Europe. Everybody has a submachine gun or a machine gun aimed at you. And you look at the train, and the train is long train. It's cattle cars. It's rust-colored cars. It's wood, sort of wood surface on a steel frame, obviously. It has a large sliding door, very small windows with barbed wire on it, and basically these cars were used moving cattle from point A to point B. Now, it's our train. The order comes by an SS officer, line up in one single file. There must be 4,000 or 5,000 in this brick factory that will be taken somewhere. We don't know where or what's going to happen. And the officer starts counting off the people. Excuse me. He gets to my father, he's number 77. My mother Bertha, 78. Sister Lily, 79. Sister Olga, 80. He takes out a piece of chalk, writes inside of the car, 80 with a circle on it, which means there are 80 human beings in here. I am number one in the next car. Now I'm separated from my family.